you know, these a's. The only thing is, we can't just divide this a by any of these a's. It's inside parentheses, and I guess the easiest answer would be, we've got an exponent which comes before division. We don't want to bypass this exponent before. We don't want to do division before that. So let's look at what the numerator is talking about. Let's get rid of that. Let's do the exponent. Let's get rid of the parentheses there. I think we can work with it.
Okay, so it'll be like 2a. So it'll be like 2 to the power of 6.
Well, let's maybe write it in a little more detail, like more steps in between.
2 times 2, 6 times.
Well,
2a.
2a
times
2a. Times 2a times 2a times 2a times 2a times a sixth 2a over, I guess we could write 8 times a if we're going to be expanding all that stuff out there.
8.
Okay. But it's not necessary to write this out that much every time, right? We're trying to justify where Clint is going. Okay. I can't exactly jump right to writing this as 2 to the 6th times 8 to the 6th. Because this is 6 2 A's multiplied together. Can I rewrite it?
Yes.
Yeah. So it's 2, or 6 2's and 6 A's? Yeah?
Separate the A's and the 2's.
Is that legal?
Yes.
Why?
Because.
Wait, is it legal?
Location?
Is it mathematically legal?
Oh,
yes.
Math. Yeah. Okay, I thought you were talking about like the drugs going down or something.
Yeah, that's a good assumption.
Yeah.
So what? How can I justify that? That I can just rearrange everything like that?
Equals 2A. To the 6th power, since, oh wait, no, never mind.
So what people are wanting to do is write this as 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times A times A times A times A. Can we do that?
I guess, yeah, because they're all, if you put a variable, I mean, a number in for A,
okay,
then that's still equal to the same thing, because you can multiply anything in any order.
Good way to look at it. So I've got a 5 there.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And 2 times 5, 2 times 5, 2 times 5, 2 times 5. It would be the same as if I multiplied it in that order as if I just multiplied all these 2 together, all these 5s together, and multiplied those two numbers together. It's all the same.
Right.
Good. Very good. So we can do that. A times A. So let's rewrite it as a normal human being might write it. 2 to the 6th times A to the 6th over A squared. Then can simplify it further. Aiden?
2 of the bottom A's cross out 2 of the top A's.
We could see it in this step if we wanted to show it. Yeah. What do we mean when we say cross out? Because that's not math.
Cancel.
Cancel out.
Also not math.
Cancel
can mean several different things. They divide. They divide. They're dividing. They're not subtracting. This A is being divided by this A. This A is being divided by this A. And we're just left with 4 A's.
Right.
Which is A to the 4th. 2 to the 6th, A to the 4th. Because 2 of those got divided by these 2. There's just 4 left. Okay?
Great.
Can I figure that out by taking 2 away from 6? Can I subtract 2 from 6 and figure out that the exponent of this A is going to be 4?
Yeah.
Yeah, because it follows naturally that there's 6 of them. You can divide these 2 away, so there are 2 fewer than there were before. Okay. I didn't subtract the A's. The A's divided each other. There's not even really any subtraction here. It's just that to figure out how many A's are left, there were 6. 2 of them are going to get divided to a 1, and so we know now that there are 4 left. And 17 is the other one?
Mm-hmm.
So we learned about negative exponents, but now we're kind of putting it all together into one expression, seeing if we can handle negative exponents with other stuff. So what do you think you might do?
Could we write it on x times x times x?
Okay.
I don't know if that helps anything.
Oh, it's certainly So I think we should try. Try just multiplying it out or just kind of exploding it out like that. What about this negative 2? If it was a 2, if it was just 2, positive 2, then I could make sense of it. Guys, I can see you. So what should we do about that negative? We learned about negative exponents yesterday. How can we handle negative exponents? How can I rewrite a negative exponent as a positive exponent?
Oh, you can go ahead and put a 1 over.
Okay, yeah, so negative exponents are positive exponents if we put them in the denominator. Or if they're in the denominator, if we move them to the numerator, we can write them as positive exponents. Okay, is that it? I mean, just write it as 3x multiplied together with a positive 2 there?
No.
No, what are we going to do?
Two groups
of 3x's. Which is, that's multiplication, right? To figure out how many x's there are. If there's two groups of 3x's, 2 times 3 is 6x's, or just count them out, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, which I'm not surprised, because the way Aiden worded it is great. Two groups of 3x's, that's exactly how we learned multiplication the very first day we ever learned multiplication. I would imagine on that first day, somebody, your teacher, said two groups of 3. Yeah, there's another way we could do it. This is a very good, like very mathematical, step by step. I like it a lot. I could also say that could I multiply 3 times negative 2 and get negative 6?
Yeah, and then you could put a 1 over that.
And we could go write x to the 6th in the denominator.
Right.
Okay. So this is one of those things where it's like it's hard to explain it. This is a great explanation of why we can arrive at that. Aside from the moving it down to the denominator, I'm not sure how many of us remember why a negative exponent means that we're actually talking about a number in the denominator to a positive power. But aside from that, like this is a good step-by-step, very logical progression. This one, we're just multiplying these two together because we just remember that property. It doesn't make a lot of sense why I would multiply the 3 times the negative 2. If somebody were to ask me, why can we multiply the 3 times the negative 2 and get a negative 6 exponent, what would you do if somebody asked you to explain why you could do that 3 times negative 2 is negative 6 like that? What reasoning would you give them?
If you put a 1 over it, then that kind of simplifies it to make it into a positive.
So kind of like this, except for leave it as x to the third?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's pretty good. Just put it down there. Okay, and then you can explain why x to the third to the second is x to the sixth, right?
Right.
Without too much difficulty. That's good. That's great. I was thinking I might just make up another example. Forget about that one for a second. Let's say we had y to the fifth to the third. I'll show you why you can multiply these two exponents when they're positive. You can see why it works when they're positive. And then we'll say, well, we'll just make it work when they're negative. We'll allow that property to also work when they're negative. But we get that explanation in Bridger's approach because we just go ahead and make it a positive exponent, and then we can even write it out and explain why that works. Yeah?
So, like that, you put out the 3x's, and then it gets rid of the parentheses, I guess, and then you have 3x.
So like this?
Yeah, and then that's...
Yeah, that's... The only thing I'm saying there is like, we never quite use the idea of multiplying the exponents. Right? And so I just wanted to talk about that for a second. You just wrote it out and it's great. And I think if you got in the habit of writing it out the long way, over and over and over, you'd eventually get sick of doing that and find a shortcut around it, right? But that's exactly why these properties exist. Somebody in history is writing this down, and he's expanding it out and thought, you know, I'm just gonna wind up with two groups of three x's. I know there's gonna be six of them, so I'll just multiply those together. It's obvious, right? It becomes obvious to them because they didn't skip over that understanding step. All right. Seem clear?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So we're gonna take a
moment today, so let's
get out a piece of paper. Let's try and graduate onto using these properties, because we do want to be able to use them. We want to be fluid to them. Subtract exponents when it makes sense to. Multiply them when it makes sense. Add them when it makes sense. Divide them when it makes sense. We've got this adding rule, this subtracting, this multiplying. But then there's got to be a dividing one, right? In
yes.
Some situation. They don't come up here. Not right now, though. So 7 to the 9th over 7 to the 3rd is going to be 7 to the... What?
7 to the 6th.
To the 6th. Oh, that'd be like the final answer.
Yeah.
Hopefully what's happening is you're just like getting a little tired of writing this out. You see it play out in your head just real briefly, real quickly, like a little movie of that happening. But you quickly just take the 3 from the 9, and that's how you know how many 7s are left to multiply together. Okay? I don't want for you to go through the discomfort of moving on without ever having understood why 7 to the 9th over 7 to the 3rd is 7 to the 9 minus 3 power. Because later on, when it's harder to understand why that is and you forget what you're supposed to do, here's the most common thing that I get in this realm. You have like an x squared to the 5th, and someone asks me, is this x to the 7th or x to the 10th? I can't remember.
And then we know.
It's a huge bummer, right? You feel like a silly goose. So I'm going to, instead of say, oh, it's x to the 10th. What good does that do you? Because you're just going to forget the next time. I'm going to re-explain it real quick. Say, we got 5 groups of 2, you remember that? Oh, great, yeah, now I remember. Right? Even I forget which rule is when, but it takes me about half a second to remember because I just expanded out. Of course, there's 10 x's there, not 7. This one. If I use the same property, I'll get x to the what?
Negative fifth
no, power.
And then you drag it and put it over 1s with a positive 5.
That's yeah,
it.
I forgot that step.
I'm not going to mark you wrong if you left it like this instead of writing it like that. That's okay. But we have to know that this can be done.
Mm-hmm.
But that is what x to the negative fifth means. So before we move on too far, I want you to help me explain again, why? Why is x to the negative fifth 1 over x to the fifth? To do this, you're going to kind of have to make up some things. Like, we could have gotten it because we did this. Oliver?
Like, when you write it out, and there's, like, the x's on top, x on the bottom.
Okay, so give me a scenario where some x's are on top and some x's are on bottom, where it would work out this way. Totally make it up yourself.
X squared.
Cubed. Now it comes out to be x to the negative fifth.
Oh, I thought you meant just any.
No, not any, but it comes out specifically to be x to the negative 5.
Oh, then 10 to the 5.
So which way? 5 here or 10 here? 5 here, 10 here. So 5 minus 10 would be negative 5. And then you're going to explain why x to the negative 5. You know, using the subtraction, of course, that x to the negative 5 would be. But then how can we take this and explain why it must be that? Go ahead.
When you write it out, like, 5 x is on top.
Uh-huh.
And 10
you had to pick
bottom.
10, huh? Okay, here we go. A lot of the x's would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. All right. And then what happens?
You cancel the count.
That one, 3 of those, 4. Was 5
and
cancel.
Since the 5 x's are left on the bottom,
mm-hmm.
They're the denominator.
Yes. So there's 5 left. So there are these 5 x's being multiplied together. It turns out, though, that they're in the denominator of a fraction. Correct. Great explanation. I think we talked about this. What about 1 over x to the negative 3? Like, what is that?
But, oh, so you just go ahead and you rewrite it.
Rewrite it.
X. 2 over 3.
What's that?
Just x to the power of 3.
x to the power of 3. All right, so now we know that x to the negative 3 means 1 over x to the third. How can I be sure it's just that easy? That x to the negative 3, just make it x to the third over 1, like basically move it into the numerator.
You can plug a number in for x and see if it's true. Hmm.
2.
How do I do that? I don't know, you can't.
Because you can't do 2 times 2.
Don't let me fool you. Your calculator can do negative exponents. It's not going to have any trouble doing that. So you can do 1 over 3 to the negative third power or whatever. But I'm interested in you proving to, most importantly, yourself, maybe others, and then lastly to me, that you get why this would just translate to x to the third. Aiden, did you have one? That would explain to me why, this I can see an explanation working out of why x to the negative 3 is the same as 1 over x to the third, but why is 1 over x to the negative 3 equal to x to the positive 3 in the numerator? It might make sense, but you might see it as, well, x to the negative 3 is 1 over x to the third, like I just move it to the denominator. That's not math, right? Moving things is not a mathematical concept. And so you might say, well, then just the reverse is true. Okay, and that kind of follows that rule, but just using what we know about negative exponents, how could I prove to you that 1 over x to the negative 3, also see a similar application of that property where x just comes up to the numerator? Think. Do I need to take this one?
Yeah.
Okay. So x to the negative 3. What's x to the negative 3?
It's
one over
divided by
one.
Itself 3 times.
Well, it's 1 divided by x 3 times. It's x times itself 3 times in the divisor. Right?
Yeah. X to the negative 3.
X to the negative 3. Just x to the negative, not 1 over x to the negative 3. What does x to the negative 3 mean? Let's just start with that. I just erased it. I'm asking you.
Wait, so x to the negative 3?
Right, so knowing that x to the negative 3 is exactly the same as 1 over x to the 3rd, and here it is, x to the negative 3, I'm just going to rewrite that as illegible 1 over x to the 3rd, right? So 3 wrote x to the negative 3 as 1 over x to the 3rd. Sort of did. That looks better. So you see what I did there?
Mm-hmm.
Not there yet.
So can't you cancel out both the 1s and then it turns into x to the power of 3?
I would say, I would not say that we can cancel out the 1s. I would just use a different explanation, I guess. I mean, it's not wrong, but that's less clear, I guess. What I would say is I'm dividing a number by a fraction. When I divide by a fraction, can I rewrite that so it looks a little better, makes a little more sense? Like when you divide fractions, unless you're using your calculator, I bet very few of you actually divide by a fraction and do something else.
Multiply by
the reciprocal. So instead of dividing 1 by 1 over x to the third, I'll multiply 1 by the reciprocal, which is x to the third over 1. Okay, now we see all the stuff. It's less magical, less reliant on your memory. If you wanted me to prove that I'm allowed to multiply by the reciprocal, I could do that as well. Alright, so let's try y to the fifth over x to the negative 3. See what you do about that. Give it a try.
Well, on to
through an approach that several people were using. And it was very nice, and I liked it very much. So they did similar to what I did here and turned the x to the negative 3 into 1 over x to the third. Because we know that's what x to the negative 3 is. So we have y to the fifth divided by 1 over x to the third. So we
made them both positive.
Well, they're both positive. That's a plus. So we multiply by the reciprocal. That's what I was. Like, how do we multiply or divide by this fraction? We multiply y to the fifth times x to the third over 1. But if I write over 1, isn't that kind of redundant?
Mm-hmm.
So I don't really have to write over 1.
Mm-hmm.
There it is. I mean, I can get rid of this little dot symbol and call it y to the fifth x to the third.
Oh, what I did was I just smashed them both together to equal yx to the 15th power. I don't know if that's right.
Is it yx to the 15th?
No,
no,
that
would
mean
that
y
not
times x to the 15th.
Yeah.
Someone blank.
What we have is 5y's times 3x's, and there's not,
oh,
you know, there's not 15 of anything in that instance.
It's a lot more simple than that.
There's not, it's just 5y's and 3x's, and you might try really hard to get those put together, but it's just not going to happen. Let's talk about the difference between these two things real quick. 2x to the third and 2x to the third. What's the difference between those two?
Oh.
Okay, Bridger, go ahead.
So when you have 2x to the first one.
This first one.
That means that you're multiplying 2x, like you're not doing anything with the 2x, you're just doing 2x times 2x times 2x, but in parentheses, that's 2 times x, then you do the power.
So you're saying this is the same as writing 2x times 2x times 2x?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
I got this.
And it disagrees.
Okay, so that one is just 2. You leave the 2 alone.
Nothing with the 2?
Yeah, it's just 3x's.
2 times 3x's.
Yeah. And then, okay, the other one is what Printer said the first one was.
2x times 2x times 2x.
Yeah.
So dumb. That is so dumb. Okay.
Think about this, Bridger. If it is what you said, if it is 2x times 2x times 2x for this one,
mm-hmm.
Well, that's, I can just multiply the 2's together and the x's together, right?
Right.
And so, well, that would be 2 times 2 times 2, which is 8, and then 3x's. But if the logic is consistent, then this would mean 8x times 8x times 8x. I'm like, I would never stop. I would just keep on multiplying three of these things together because by your instruction, it means, like, this three basically applies to this number. But it doesn't. It just applies to the x. If I wanted to apply to the number as well, I have to say this whole thing, you know, I want you to multiply all of it by itself three times.
Okay.
This is saying leave the two alone and multiply the x only by three, or no, by itself three times.
Okay.
So this would be 8x cubed, and then we would stop because the cube was not applied to the 8, only to the x. About x, y to the third. How can I write that basically so that there are no parentheses involved?
x3 times y3.
Can you quickly explain why that is?
Distributive property
is totally, totally different. Distributive property is for like 2 times x plus 3. It's multiplication, not exponents, and it has to do with these two guys being added together. So it's not the distributive property, and actually that's what I want to get us away from, because that's what people often walk away with when they see this. X times y to the third is x to the third times y to the third because of the distributive property. It's not the distributive property. In fact, after I say it this next time, I won't say the word distributive for this situation ever again. So, because I just don't want to confuse you. That's not what it is. So can we just, it wouldn't take very long to just prove that, yeah,
okay.
Okay.
Well, so
x
third times y to the third is correct.
It is.
I don't know.
Oh, even if you took x, y,
would still be 3x's and 3y's. Yes, 3x's and 3y's is what we would wind up with if we multiplied this by itself three times. x, y, group the x's, 3x's, group the y's, 3y's, x to the third, y to the third. Okay. And keep in mind, if it benefits me to do this, I can either bring it out of the parentheses or I can put it back into parentheses if I have two different variables that are raised to the same exponent. Say, well, that's the same as having 3xy multiplied by each other. Okay. So by the same token, what about m over n raised to the fifth? How can I write that so there's no x?
M5 times M5?
M to the fifth times n to the fifth?
No, never mind.
Okay,
M to the fifth over n to the fifth.
And why do you think that?
It just, like, puts them together.
Right, so you're in your head, you're expanding it out. M over n times m over n times m over n times m over n. And when we multiply fractions, we multiply straight across, so we're going to see 5m's get multiplied together, 5n's get multiplied together, just like that. N to the fifth over n to the fifth. All right, you ready for a little challenge?
Yeah.
Put it all together. You're all really excited, more than I thought.
I'm not excited.
2x squared y over z to the third to the fourth.
Well, that's easy.
I'm not good with that.
Okay, bro. You're going to want to make your best attempt, because then I'm going to throw negative exponents in there.
What?
Are you at least going to tell us how to do it before you do that?
Let's see what
he's
Aiden
smart.
Says.
Alright, so I put that in the four groups.
Oh, wow. So you're really explaining why your answer is what it is.
Oh. Well,
okay,
I did
so
that.
Copy that. Copy that. Copy that. Copy that. You did that, right? Copied and pasted it.
And then
it's a handy tool.
Did 4 2x's, so there's 2x to the 8th.
2x to the 8th.
And then I did 4y's, so y to the 4th.
Y to the 4th.
And then over 4z to the 3rd.
4z? Oh, 4z to the 3rd. Yeah, I agree with like
90%
of this.
Yeah. Yay! I actually got that.
Before we celebrate, let's listen to what I'm saying. That is not completely correct.
What? You can still do it more. If you do 2 to the power of 4, you could go negative. If you do a negative exponent on the
board. I got this, y'all.
No, you don't.
That's what I got.
Well, first of all, you said 2 to the power of 4.
Yeah,
which we don't have.
Oh, yeah, but it.
I thought
should
you would do the stuff in the parentheses first.
Okay.
Yeah, see, that's the kind of thing that messes us up.
Sally.
When we learn that,
yeah.
And then when I'm telling you this, and you get confused by why we were violating the order of operations, we're absolutely not violating the
and
order
you
of
said
operations. Because what we're doing is we are respecting the order. We're respecting that this is the thing that needs to be raised to the fourth. When we do things out of order, we wind up sometimes like not multiplying this by itself four times. Okay? If we do this incorrectly. By writing it out four times, we are respecting exactly what the exponent said we're supposed to do. There's not really anything we can do in the parentheses because they don't combine. None of these things combine and simplify and get like terms or anything like that. But again, there is something missing.
There's
a four.
This just couldn't keep it in.
It is.
2 to the 4th, right? Because there's a 2 times a 2 times a 2 times a 2, that's 4 2's.
Right.
There's x squared times the next squared times the next squared times the next squared. Separately, that is 8x's x to the 8th. Sure. 2 to the 4th is 16. 2 to the 4th is 16. So you could write 16, x to the 8th, y to the 4th, over z to the 12th. That's a 1. I need a 12. Write down your more so it's not so last minute as it usually is.
614, 22.
Can you go online and get the problems?
What do you mean?
Like, are they on your website?
They will be when I text it out later today.
Okay. No, I mean, like, on the Florence Carlton website. Oh,
he doesn't update it on that.
Okay. Cool beans.
Incorrect. When I text it, it goes on the website.
Oh, like automatically? Okay.
Yeah.
I thought it did go on the website.